afternoon, everybody. Thank God for another day among the land of the living. Thank God for Jesus. Thank God for the Word, and thank God for the Holy Spirit. You know, the Scripture says in 119 and 105 of Psalms, "Thy Word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path." It will show us the way to go. It gives us instruction. 2 Timothy 3:16 says, "All Scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for correction, for reproof, for correction, and for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect and thoroughly furnished unto all good works." And it's Jesus working inside of us. Philippians 1:6 says, "Being confident of this very thing, that he which hath begun a good work in you will perform it to the day of Jesus Christ." And so God gets all the credit. It's nothing that we've done. There's one thing that we do. There's one work that the Scriptures say that we work. And it says, "This is the work, that you believe on the name of the Lord Jesus." And so, you know, it all comes back to the blood of Jesus, you know, the finished work of the cross, and us putting our faith and trust in him for everything we do, and for our salvation, for sanctification, for, you know, just for everything in our life. And so we love God, you know, because he first loved us. And, you know, when you think about the goodness of Jesus and all he's done for us, it should make you happy. Amen. So we're going to want to do a little study today, Galatians 5. We're going to go to Galatians 5 and begin at verse 1. Galatians 5 and verse, I think I want to start at verse 1. Let's see here. Yeah, let's start in verse 1. Let's say a quick prayer. Father, in Jesus' name, we thank you for your goodness and mercy. We thank you for this day. Help us as we read your word to get something out of it. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, let's do it. Chapter 5, we'll start at verse 1 of Galatians. It says, "Stand fast, therefore, in the liberty wherewith Christ hath made us free, and be not entangled again with the yoke of bondage. Behold, I, Paul, say unto you, that if ye be circumcised," that's in the flesh, the circumcision that the covenant God made with Abraham was that all the males would be circumcised in the flesh on the eighth day, and he's given reference to that. And it says, "Behold, I, Paul, say unto you, that if ye be circumcised, Christ shall profit you nothing. For I testify again to every man that is circumcised, that he is a debtor to do the whole law. Christ is become of no effect unto you. Whosoever of you are justified by the law, ye are fallen from grace. For we through the Spirit wait for the hope of righteousness by faith." So what this is saying here is that we're under liberty. We've been set free. We're not under the law anymore. We're under grace. And so it says not to be entangled again with the yoke of bondage. "Behold, I, Paul, say unto you, that if you be circumcised, Christ shall profit you nothing." At this time, there was a group of false teachers that were teaching, telling the Galatian church that they had to be circumcised, that they had to obey the law of Moses. And so, you know, the church had just been formed, and we know we're saved by grace through faith in Christ Jesus alone, and the what he did for us at the cross. And they were teaching the church, the false prophets were coming and teaching, and the false teachers were teaching them that they still had to obey the law. And so Paul is telling him, you know, we're not under the law anymore. We're under grace. And if you choose to be under the law, if you want to try to make it in and live according to the law, then you're falling from grace. You're not under grace. You can't be under grace and under the law. It's one or the other. And if you choose to try to be under the law, and make it in and save yourself, you're going to fall. You're going to fail. It's written in the scriptures. You're guilty. So you can't be under the law and under grace. It's one or the other. And if you're under the law, if you're circumcised and you try to live under the law, it won't profit you anything. You won't be under the grace of God. Verse 4, Christ has become of no effect unto you, whosoever of you are justified by the law. Ye are fallen from grace. So if you try to be justified by the law, you're fallen from grace. Verse 5, for we through the Spirit wait for the hope of righteousness by faith. We wait for the hope of righteousness by faith. It all comes back to faith. Faith in Jesus. Verse 6, for in Jesus Christ neither circumcision availeth anything, nor uncircumcision, but faith which worketh by love. You did run well. Who did hinder you, that ye should not obey the truth? This persuasion cometh not of him that calleth you. A little leaven leaveneth the whole lump. I have confidence in you through the Lord, that ye will be none otherwise minded, but he that troubleth you shall bear his judgment, whosoever he be. And I, brethren, if I yet preach circumcision, why do I yet suffer persecution? Then is the offense of the cross ceased. I would they were even cut off, which trouble you. So we're not under the law, we're under grace, and these teachers, these false teachers have been teaching them that they had to be under the law, and they still had to follow the law of Moses, even though they were now under grace and truth. See, once Jesus came and he paid our sin debt in full, he fulfilled the law of the prophets, and he paid that sin debt in full. See, under the law, you know, it was impossible that the blood of bulls and goats could save us from our sins and wash away our sins. It was impossible, but the blood of Jesus, once Jesus came and he lived the perfect life. See, he's the only one that ever lived this thing perfectly. He fulfilled the law to a T, and no man has ever done that but Jesus Christ. We've all fallen short. We all are guilty. The law actually shows us how guilty we are. We're in a nasty flesh. We've fallen, you know, we're a fallen people, thanks to Adam's transgression. And so that's just the state we're in. If you read in Genesis chapter 6, let me try to find this really fast. It talks about the horrible state of man, the horrible condition that our heart is actually in. I believe it's chapter 6. I want to try to find this really fast and see if I can find it. It talks about the condition of the heart. I thought it was in chapter 6, maybe not. But it talks about how our heart is desperately wicked. Well, I don't see it in here. Oh, here we go. Chapter 8. Verse 21, this isn't the one I was looking for, but it says here, and the Lord smelled a sweet savior, and the Lord said in his heart, I will not again curse the ground anymore for man's sake, for the imaginations of the heart of man's heart is evil from his youth, neither will I again smite anymore every living thing as I have done. So that's not the one I was looking for, but that lets you know right there the condition of man's heart and how evil it is from his youth. So let's get back to the scriptures. So because of Adam's transgression, we've all fallen short. We all are guilty. And, you know, on judgment day, when we stand before the Lord, we're going to be guilty. We have that sin nature in us, that Adam nature. That's why we must be born again. But once you're born again, you're not under the law. See, Jesus took care of that. The new covenant that we're under is we're saved by the blood of Jesus. The blood of Jesus washes away the sins of the world. The old covenant they were under the law of Moses that God had given. And they, you know, they offered up, they had different rituals they had, and they offered up the blood of animals for sacrifices to wash, to bring them into good standing with God. But once Jesus came, he did away with that. And now we are, our sins are washed away by the blood of Jesus. Hebrews 10:10 says, by the which will we are sanctified through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ once for all. The new covenant, we're saved by the blood of Jesus. And the blood of Jesus washes away our sins. So you can either choose to be under the law and try to save yourself under the law and live this thing perfectly, which you will fail. The Bible tells us so. We all are guilty. The law shows us how guilty we are. Or you can be under grace and under the blood of Jesus through repentance and faith in him. And it says here, verse 10, I have confidence in you through the Lord that ye will be none otherwise minded, but he that troubleth you shall bear his judgment, whosoever he be. And God is the avenger. Don't go trying to avenge people that do wrong. They do you wrong, God will avenge them in due time. You just love them, be kind to them, be respectful, and God will take care of things in due time. Verse 12, I would they were even cut off which trouble you. 13, for brethren, ye have been called unto liberty, only use not liberty for an occasion to the flesh, but by love serve one another. Verse 7, I want to read that really fast. I just found it. I was looking for that a little earlier. Ye did run well. Who did hinder you that ye should not obey the truth? Amen. You did run well. See, they started out. They received the Holy Spirit by faith, and they were born again believers, and then they started to go sidetrack and go back into the law and trying to you know, live and doing things to under the law, which was done away with, but they started out well. Verse 1 says, O foolish Galatians, this is Galatians 3:1, who hath bewitched you that ye should not obey the truth, before whose eyes Jesus Christ hath been evidently set forth, crucified among you? This only would I learn of you, received ye the Spirit by the works of the law? So did you receive the Spirit of God by the works of the law, or by the hearing of faith? See, they received the Holy Spirit by faith, not by the works of the law. And he says, you did run well. You started out well, but you've gone astray. You've gone sidetracked. You know, we're not under the law anymore. So don't go trying to live under the law. If you do, you're falling from grace. Okay, back to verse 13. For brethren, you have been called unto liberty. Only use not liberty for an occasion to the flesh, but by love serve one another. So you've been called into liberty. We've been set free by the blood of Jesus. We're no longer under the law. We're no longer under that bondage of sin, but we've been set free by the blood of Jesus. Verse 14, he says, you're free. You're not under the law. You have liberty now, but make sure you don't use your liberty for an occasion to the flesh. But by love, serve one another. We're supposed to love one another. The scripture says, by this shall they know you are my disciples, by the love you have one for another. And we don't want to fulfill the lusts of the flesh just because we're under liberty. We've been set free, but that doesn't give you a license to just sin and do the works of the flesh. We're going to read about that here on down. Verse 14, for all the law is fulfilled in one word, even in this, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. For if you bite and devour one another, take heed that you be not consumed one of another. See, you can destroy each other by biting and devouring each other, but we don't want to do that. We want to love one another. And when you love, you show love to each other, that fulfills the law. You know, love does not work ill to his brother. Love cares for his brothers and sisters. Love will, you know, feed those in need. You'll want to help your brothers and sisters out when they're in trouble. Amen. You got to show love one to another. Verse 16. This I say then, walk in the Spirit, and ye shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. See, like I said earlier, and I like this scripture so much, 2 Timothy 3:16 says, all scripture is given by inspiration of God, and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction. So it reproves us, it corrects us, and then it instructs us in righteousness. It instructs us on the ways of the Lord. So things we're doing, it shows us what we should not be doing, and then it shows us what we should be doing as born-again believers in Christ. And this says, this I say, walk in the Spirit, and you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. For the flesh lusteth against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. And these are contrary the one to the other, so that you cannot do the things you would. But if you be led of the Spirit, ye are not under the law. Amen. So you have the Spirit, the Holy Spirit dwelling inside of you, and then you have the flesh, and they don't agree. They don't go together. They don't mix good. The flesh wants you to sin and you know, fulfill the lust of the flesh, which is sin, but the Holy Spirit is saying, no, don't do that. And so you have this constant battle of, in your mind and in your spirit, you want to do the right thing, but in your flesh, it's constantly trying to get you to do the wrong thing. So you need to stay plugged into the Holy Spirit. And it says if you walk in the Spirit, you won't fulfill the lust of the flesh. And the way you walk in the Spirit is I like to say that you've got your power plug-in for the Holy Spirit, and you got your power plug-in for the flesh. And the way you stay plugged into the Holy Spirit, get that power source plugged into that Holy Spirit, is you focus on Jesus, you meditate on Jesus, you meditate in the Word of God, you study the Word of God, you listen to the right music. The Scripture says, 5 and 18 of Ephesians, be not drunk with wine, but be filled with the Spirit, speaking to yourselves with psalms and spiritual hymns, and make a melody in your heart, giving thanks to the Lord. Stay full of the Spirit by focusing and meditating on the right things and trusting in Jesus for all you do. When you place your faith and trust in Jesus and you stay focused on that and you trust in Him for everything and you magnify Him, then that allows the Holy Spirit, which dwells inside of the believer, to do His job. And He'll clean you up. He'll get rid of all that junk that you were doing before. And you'll begin to shine, and that light will shine because He cleans you up. And you're trusting in Jesus. The Holy Spirit cleans you up from the inside out. And then you can be an example to the others. Amen. Now, this is instruction. It's going to give a list of different sins, different works of the flesh. It says, now this I say, walk in the Spirit, and you will not fulfill the lust of the flesh. So walk in the Spirit, and you won't fulfill the lust of the flesh, which we're about to name. Verse 19, now the works of the flesh are manifest. See, the works of the flesh are manifest. When you're plugged into the outlet of the flesh, excuse me. Now the works of the flesh are manifest, which are these: adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, variance, emulations, wrath, strife, seditions, heresies, envyings, murders, drunkenness, revelings, and such like, of the which I tell you before, as I have told you in time past, that they which do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. That's a serious statement. You will not inherit the kingdom of God if you do these things. Those are works of the flesh. Those are sins that you ought not to do. Get a dictionary and look every one of these words up, and it will tell you exactly what these sins are. Those are things that you don't want to do. For the sake of time, I'm not going to go through each of them, but you can Google them. Bible dictionary will tell you exactly what these different things are. Those are works of the flesh. And if you're not plugged into the Spirit, if you're not walking in the Spirit, those works of the flesh will manifest themselves, meaning you're walking in the flesh and not in the Spirit. Those are things you ought not to do as a born-again believer. Don't do those things. But, verse 22, the fruit of the Spirit. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such there is no law. There is no law against those things. See, the law is for the unrighteous. The law was brought forth to show us what sin was and to show us what we were doing. It showed us the things that were wrong, that God did not want us to do. It's sin. These are different sins, the Ten Commandments. You know, it let us know what was right and what was wrong. And so these different, if you're walking in the Spirit, if you're staying plugged into the Spirit, you're going to manifest the fruit. The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against there is no law. And they that are Christ have crucified the flesh. You've got to crucify the flesh with the affections and the lust. If we live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit. Let us not be desirous of vainglory, provoking one another, envying one another. Amen. They shall know you by your fruits. Can a tree, if you read over in James, well, anyways, James chapter 3 talks about let's find it really fast. It's the main thing chapter 3 is talking about is that tongue and how evil it can be, and it's a bad thing. A little element, a little part of the body, a little member that can just set everything on fire. It's horrible. But down here in verse 12, chapter 3, verse 12 says, can the fig tree, my brethren, bear olive trees, either a vine, figs? So can no fountain both yield salt water and fresh. So what that's saying is when you're born again believer, you have the Holy Spirit dwelling inside of you, it should produce fruit. The Holy Spirit will manifest the fruit, amen, that comes forth from the Holy Spirit. Love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, forbearance. All those are fruit of the Spirit. And so when you're staying plugged into the Holy Spirit, that fruit will manifest itself. And then your light will shine. You could be an example to others. But if you're plugged into the flesh, it's going to manifest all those acts of sin, which we don't want to do. Amen. This is instruction. It's important that we walk in the Holy Spirit. I want to read one more scripture. See, this, it gives us instruction on how to live our life. It tells us what not to do, and it tells us what to do. It tells us how not to behave ourselves, and it tells us how to behave ourselves. It's getting hot in here. Can't turn my AC on because it's too, the vehicle's too loud. So I'm going to try to finish this up really fast. Chapter 6, I want to share this. Chapter 6, verse 16 and 17 and 18. These six things doth the Lord hate, yea, seven are an abomination unto him. A proud look, that's the number one thing. Don't be a proud person. God does not like prideful prideful people. A proud look is, don't do it. He doesn't like people who are proudful. A lying tongue, don't be lying. And hands that shed innocent blood, don't shed innocent blood. A heart that deviseth wicked imagination, somebody that thinks up a bunch of evil in their heart. Feet that be swift in running to mischief, running to all the things that are going on that are wicked, and you know, all the drama that's not of the Lord, all the, you know, there's killings and fights and a bunch of just sinful activities. You can't wait to go see about that. It shouldn't be like that when you're born again, living for Jesus. Okay, a false witness that speaketh lies, somebody that lies and tells lies on people, and he that soweth discord among the brethren, that's somebody that goes and starts up a bunch of trouble and problems with other brothers and sisters, tries to stir the pot and just mingle up a bunch of stuff they shouldn't be doing. So these things are things that God hates. And when you read about things that are acts of sin, things that are not okay in God's eyes, don't do it. The scripture says in 119:11 of Psalms, thy word have I hid in my heart that I might not sin against thee. Find out all these different acts of sins that God is not okay with. See, sin is transgression against the law. Sin is transgression against God's ways. It's disobedience. It's not obeying the commandments, the law, and these different acts of, you know, he tells us how to live our life. He gives us instruction. So when you know something's wrong, don't do it. The scripture says, to him that knows to do good and does it not, to him it is sin. That can be found in James. When you know something's good and you do it not, when you know the way of the Lord and you choose not to live in obedience to him, then that's acts of sin. I want to read that really fast. That's an important scripture if I could find it. It says, to him that doeth, that knows to do good and does it not, to him it is sin. Let's see, chapter 5 maybe? I know it's in here. Let's see here. To him that, well, I'm not finding it. I wanted to find it in here, but I'm not seeing it. I'm scanning one last time. I know it's in here. I'll probably go look for it as soon as I'm done. Yeah, I'm not finding it. Anyways, it says, to him that doeth, that knows to do good and does it not, to him to sin. You can Google it. That's in James chapter 4 or 5. But God is good. He's worthy to be praised. We want to make sure that we're applying the scriptures to our life. When we see things that God does not like, we don't do them. The scripture says, if you love me, in 14 and 15 of St. John, if you love me, keep my commandments. So we strive every day. Now we know you strive every day to live free from sin. But you must understand, you're not saved by your works. You're saved by faith in Christ Jesus and the finished work at the cross. And when you do that, when you place all your faith in him, you're born again. And then you now have the Holy Spirit dwelling inside of you. You now have a desire to live right. But you must understand that it's not your works that gets you into heaven. Ephesians 2 and 8 says, we're saved by grace through faith in Jesus Christ, not of your works, lest any man should boast. So it's all about what Jesus did for us. He gets all the credit. And one last scripture I want to read is 1 John chapter 2 and 1. And it says, my little children, these things write unto you, that ye sin not. But, let's see, I lost my spot. But, let's see, my little children, these things I write unto you, that ye sin not. And if any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous, and he is the propitiation for our sins, and not only for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. Amen. So we know that we're saved by the blood of Jesus. Our sins have been atoned for by the sacrifice he made for us at the cross. He was the propitiation for us. You know, he took upon himself the wrath that we deserve. That's why, see, it's, the scripture says that we're not appointed under wrath. The children of God are not appointed under wrath because Jesus took upon himself the wrath that we deserve. And we have a lot to be thankful for. Because of the blood of Jesus, we can escape that death sentence placed upon us, and we can inherit the gift of eternal life through believing the gospel message, the death, the burial, resurrection. Jesus paid your sin debt in full, and believing it with all of your heart, mind, and soul, and trusting in it and placing your faith in it, in the death, burial, resurrection. And when you do that, you're born again. And, you know, the Holy Spirit comes in. It's a gift. It helps you live this life in a pleasing way to God. It instructs us. It brings things to our remembrance. And it's the greatest teacher is the Holy Spirit. So God is good. He's worthy to be praised. We have a lot to be thankful for. And just do the best you can every day to live a life pleasing to God. And trust in Jesus with all of your heart for everything you do. and he'll bless you down here. We'll gain the gift of eternal life, and thank God we have a lot to be thankful for. Thank God for the blood of Jesus. Have a wonderful day. God bless y'all, and Lord willing, I'll see you next time I do a video. So hopefully, Lord willing, Monday I'll do another video. Have a wonderful day. Love God with all of your heart, and love your neighbor as yourself. Amen. Let that light shine. Have a blessed day. I love y'all, and God bless.